Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2022. We have apologies from James Dornan, and I'm delighted to welcome Natalie Dawn, MSP, who joins us for the first time today as a substitute member. You're very welcome, Natalie. I thank you, Natalie, for being here, and invite you to declare your any interests that are relevant to the remit of the committee. Natalie.
Thank you, Convener. Just because I haven't sat in this committee, I'd like to declare that I'm still a councillor within Renfrewshire Council. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Natalie. Sorry, Oliver, did you want
I did, Convener. Before we begin taking evidence, there's a point I wish to raise and seek your clarification on. I suspect I'm not the only committee member who's been concerned by reports that the Scottish Government are still, over a year later, withholding from publication the draft version of the OECD report it received last January and their subsequent response to it. Furthermore, I've also heard a parliamentary statement is now planned on the Kenmuir report, and it's been reported that senior leadership at the SQA and other education bodies have already seen advanced drafts. I'm not aware of this courtesy having been extended to this committee in what looks like a repeat as the same situation as with the OECD, where unaccountable organisations who are currently failing our young people are extended an opportunity to review and potentially influence the findings of these reports without any checks and balances. Having been a member of this committee over a number of years, I believe it's insulting that such documents have not been made readily available to this committee, and that this practice of excluding Parliament and denying us the fullest opportunity to exercise our scrutiny function diminishes the work we do. To me, this is unacceptable, and I believe we should urgently be requesting these documents. I know we are to cover our work programme in private today, but I'm increasingly concerned that too much of our education policy is decided behind closed doors, not least because of the culture of secrecy and the lack of transparency at the heart of the SNP's approach. I think it's important that the public know we are alive to these issues and that as a committee we're taking our job of scrutiny seriously. Ideally, I would therefore like to see a decision taken to move our work programme discussion today into public session to allow this urgent matter to be addressed. However, if that's not possible, I would like to seek your assurance that this matter could be put on the public agenda for next week.
Right, well, let me consider what you have said. Bob indicated he wanted to say something, and I think it's only fair that I allow him the same privileges I've allowed Oliver.
Just very briefly, Convener, it is, of course, for Mr Mundell to whatever points he seeks to make at this committee. I'm conscious when this committee started, in this session, we said we work collegiately, we'd work cross-party, and we'd challenge the government as and when appropriate, in the strongest possible fashion when we had to, but we'd seek to work constructively with government and constructively across this committee. I'm therefore disappointed we get a set-piece statement from Mr Mundell, which I would consider grandstanding. There's been lots of opportunities to raise these concerns within committee before now, including this morning, indeed, where you yourself convened on private session and said, does anyone else want to make us aware of anything that they might wish to raise at today's meeting? No member afforded themselves that opportunity at that time. So I'm keen to work collegiately as a committee to decide how best to respond to Mr Mundell's comments. But the idea of ambushing a committee at the start of a meeting when he's had lots of other opportunities to put this to fellow committee members and work collegiately, I find very disappointing. I find the tone unhelpful. I find it overtly party politicised, and it's not the way I want this committee to work.
Well, Bob, I can perfectly understand the sentiment behind your words, but I've now Willie Rennie has indicated your seat. To be fair, having allowed two colleagues, I don't think I can not.
I think Oliver Mundell's got a point. There has been deep frustration that the government haven't been as open as I think they should be over the OECD process. And I think it's important that it's highlighted that this committee takes a direct interest, that we have a public session on it, that we seek evidence from the government. We seek an appeal to them to give us the more information that we've been asking for months. And I think it would be wrong with the media scrutiny on this wasn't replicated with scrutiny by this committee, because I think we've got a massive responsibility. So I would like to see a public session. However this has been brought up, I think it's important that we actually do take our role seriously and actually do scrutinise the government and seek the openness that I think teachers and pupils deserve. So I would like to see a session on this at a future committee meeting.
Thank you, Willie. Ross.
Thanks, Convener. And again, briefly, I mean, if the reports of the SQA attempting to limit the damage to their reputation in the OECD report are true, they obviously didn't do a very good job of it, because the Scottish Government has decided to abolish and replace the SQA. On the question of how we take this forward as a committee, I agree absolutely that there's a need for substantial public parliamentary scrutiny of this process. I would prefer that we discuss how we are going to do that as a committee in the normal way through our normal work planning procedures. If we decide at our work planning discussion after the public session of this meeting that we're going to move forward with public sessions, then we will do so. They will be on the record. But I don't like the implication that the way parliamentary committees go about their normal work planning, i.e. in private, so that we can flush out the issues collectively and decide how we're going to go about it publicly. I don't like the implication that that is somehow a behind-closed-doors process that lacks scrutiny in and of itself. That is the normal way that Parliament functions. I'm quite sure that as a result of our private session today on our work planning meeting, we will make decisions about what we're going to do in public about this, as we would have done regardless of what's just happened this morning.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, thank you for that. I think... Michael.
Thanks, Convener. I've got a lot of sympathy with all the contributions so far, I have to say. In terms of what Mr Mundell says, the core of it, I do think that the early drafts of this, the pre-amendment, should be published, should absolutely be in the public domain, and we should see them, and we should be able to have a look at that. And I think all the other comments in terms of how we work as a committee, I also agree with those that we want to do that collegiately and work together. But I think we need to find a way to tell government that we want to see these publications and see them quickly. And that we want to be able to understand the process of amendment and the influence that's brought to bear on them. So if we maybe come to a resolution on this, how we do that, I think, is the question. But I think we want to be pretty clear that we should see that publication as soon as possible.
Right. Well, you know, this is not an agenda item that we're following today. And Bob Doris made the point that I did ask in the pre-meeting if there was anything people wanted to raise about the meeting. And there was no mention in that meeting of this item. So I think my response to all of this is that we should consider this further when we meet in private later this morning. We should have a discussion about that, or, you know, and consider it further. But, I mean, everyone's had a fair chance to make their views known, and I think that is my role here as the convener. But having said that, I do think we should consider this further in the private session we've got for this morning, and we should move on to our agenda item as planned. And I hope you all agree with that. And the item that I think we should move on to is the main item, for which we were delighted to welcome guests into Parliament physically in our committee room. And that is to take evidence on as part of our Scottish Attainment Challenge inquiry. And our focus this week is on the work of the third sector organisations, which provide services funded through the Attainment Challenge. And as I said, I'd like to welcome our witnesses this morning. We have Jim Wallace, Director of Children and Families at Aberlour Childcare Trust. And Jim is joining us, I think, remotely. Yes, there he is. Maureen McAteer, Assistant Director, Bernardo Scotland, who's with us in the committee room. Sarah, is it Sarah or Sarah? I should have asked that, shouldn't I, earlier? Sarah?
It's Sarah.
Yeah. Sarah, OK, right. Sarah, I do apologise. Sarah Spencer, Cost of the School Day Project Manager of the Child Poverty Action Group in Scotland, who's remote, and Louise Goodlad, who's Senior Head of Partnerships Scotland, the Prince's Trust Scotland, and you're all very welcome. So to get us underway this morning, I think given the fact that we're considering the work of the third sector in relation to the Scottish Attainment Challenge, perhaps I can ask, start perhaps with Maureen. Maureen, why is the work that Bernardo's does in relation to the Attainment Challenge, why is this additive? Is it additional to what was going on before? What's the value of the third sector involvement in this from your point of view?
Well, alongside a lot of other third sector organisations, we've always worked in partnerships with families and communities and schools. But from a Barnardo's perspective, we've definitely been able to extend our involvement with schools through the Scottish Attainment Challenge. So just to give you a bit of an idea of scale, we work in 400 schools across Scotland, and probably about a third of that is funded through the Scottish Attainment Challenge. And that work tends to take a sort of range of different forms. It can be one-to-one support for children in school. It can be group work with children in school. We do a lot of family support, so strengthening that link between the home, the family and the community. And obviously a lot of work around, I suppose, removing barriers for children's participation in their education. So a lot of work around reducing anxiety, a lot of work around improving self-esteem, improving engagement in their learning, and also thinking about families and what particularly might be getting in the way of a child optimising their engagement in school. And a lot of that obviously does relate to child poverty.
What do you bring that wasn't already there? Because presumably if you weren't there, that these functions, this role that you're playing, would be played by someone else
in
the public sector.
Yeah, I think that the additionality, now it doesn't necessarily need to be a third sector provider that does that, but it often is. I think that the role that we have in terms of the work we do is very much focused on the child within the family and within the community. So it's about a recognition that some of the challenges that are barriers to learning are not within the class environment or the school environment. A lot of the barriers are actually to do with what's going on in a child's life outside of school. You all know children spend 80% of their time out with school, so what happens in their family and in their community can have a huge influence on their capacity to engage in the learning opportunities that they have.
Greer in, because I think he's got a line of questioning that'll go down this line as well, and then I can chip in.
Thank you, Kimir, and maybe start off with Maureen, but this is a question for everyone on the panel. And I say this with no prejudgment, but I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on why the third sector are providing something that councils either won't or can't. What's the unique contribution that justifies quite a significant amount of money being given to third sector organisations to deliver this, as opposed to being delivered through councils themselves, regional improvement collaboratives, if it's about scale, etc. Why the third sector rather than the public sector, I suppose, is what I'm asking.
I think the third sector bring a kind of unique set of skills. Our focus is specifically on, it's on wellbeing in its widest sense. So we're able to think about the child not just within their class environment, as our education colleagues tend to do, and thinking about how those links that I've mentioned earlier between the family and the community. And our staff are trained in relational practice, they're trained in trauma-informed approaches, they can think about how to support a child who maybe finds it difficult in the school environment and bring a sort of different lens to what might work in an educational environment, or provide stepping stones for a child to reintegrate fully into their learning environment.
Thanks. Any of our other panellists like to come in on that wider question of why the third sector is providing something the public sector can't or won't? Maybe we'll ask folk who are joining us remotely first. Jim, do you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think a big strength of the third sector is the ability to kind of engage with families, and you know, we've built up a good understanding of the kind of challenges that are happening in the home as well as in the school. I mean, it's not to say that statutory providers can't do these things, but certainly the work that we've done, and I think the work of Barnardo's, you know, committee members have checked with schools, head teachers find it useful to have this additional support and to have people in with a kind of different focus on the family issues. You know, schools are under lots of pressure. They've got lots of children to work with. And, you know, I think it's useful to have kind of additional people coming in and kind of providing support. And it can really provide some kind of transformational outcomes for children. We're particularly good, I think, at listening to children and families and understanding the needs that they have and the challenges that they kind of face. And, you know, as Maureen was saying, what impacts on children's learning, there are multiple issues, and it's complex, I think, to be addressed within the school thing, the school situation. In our submission, we did some work and looked at particular children where there were kind of identified key obstacles to their learning, you know, and I think we can actually help schools kind of work with those different multiple obstacles that are barriers to children's learning in school.
Thanks. You said there, Jim, that it's not that statutory providers can't give the kind of comprehensive, holistic family support that you provide. The implication there perhaps is that they won't, or that there's some other barrier there. Are you able to expand on that? Why do you think it's possible for a statutory provider to do what you're doing, but that's not happening at the moment?
I think they just have vast pressures in terms of their resources and their demand upon their services. And I think it's about the partnership with the third sector just adds additional resource to that. And, you know, in some situations, families and children have, I think the third sector can help build bridges back to better engagement with statutory services. And that's one of the things we've noted through our family work. Sometimes people can feel kind of disengaged and mistrustful of what support's offered. Sometimes parents that we work with have had their own negative experiences of school, and that impacts on, you know, their attitudes, and that's reflected through their children. So, you know, we can work with parents and, you know, try and help them kind of view school and statutory services differently and create kind of a better footing for kind of working together.
Thanks. Sarah, would you like to come in on this question?
Sure. So speaking about cost of the school day specifically, we work with schools and local authorities around financial barriers at school for children and young people and their families, and also sort of looking at practical ways to overcome those and remove the barriers, usually focusing around reducing costs for families, costs for participation, and also focusing on incomes. So I think in terms of thinking where that fits within the Scottish Attainment Challenge, it's about removing barriers, it's about reducing costs, it's about creating the conditions for attainment and sort of the foundations that other interventions are going to stand on. So thinking of kind of why the third sector, why not anyone else, I think that in terms of what Cost of the School Day is working on, in terms of awareness and action around poverty, there are lots of different people working in that area, lots of really brilliant work in local areas from equity teams. There's the work of the attainment advisors, and you know, just a whole range of people working to do these things. I think the additional value of having third sector organisations is that they can bring, thinking of ourselves, for example, I think we would bring evidence to this from wider work of the organisation, wider research into child poverty, wider expertise on, for example, the impact of social security changes in recent years and how that impacts on families. So there's a kind of extra sort of element there. And I think importantly, what we try to do is take evidence from the schools that we work with and the children and the families that we work with and use that to try to inform policy. So I think there's something there. And I think it's something that all of the different actors working in this area find useful, that additionality there.
Thank you. And Louise, would you like to come in on this?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think the similar to what has been said, I think some of it is about the expertise that the third sector can bring. And from the Prince's Trust perspective, the work we do is in schools. And it is about working with those young people that are maybe schools not really working for them, they're struggling, and we set up almost like a separate club that's about kind of practical skills and a lot of employability skills. So really helping them move towards a kind of positive destination once they leave school. And within that, we help them with attainment through Prince's Trust qualifications that are about personal and social development and employment skills that they can gain. So, I mean, as part of that, we bring a lot of employers and our employer network with us, which is something that certainly schools can kind of struggle to do. And obviously that's, you know, there's other areas of Scottish Government policy, like developing young workforce, that are focused on that. But certainly someone like the Prince's Trust, we can bring kind of big national employers into schools and to support our work. We've also got the kind of expertise that sits behind a lot of the lesson plans and the kind of the way that we structure that programme. We bring a lot of that kind of youth work skill. And I think it's important. We find working with young people, often statutory services can be off-putting to them for whatever reason, and they find a brand like the Trust is, you know, it's a trusted brand. They know it's for young people. So it can, you know, because a lot of this is, as Sarah said, is about those underlying foundations that help attainment. So it's that kind of confidence, it's motivation, it's engagement. And I guess I would also kind of question when you said about, you know, there's an awful lot of money going out of the attainment challenge to the third sector. One of the reasons I was keen to be here today is because I think it's interesting there's a perception that we benefit a lot from the attainment challenge. And actually, we are funded by local authorities, but as far as I'm aware, none of them have named that as attainment challenge funding. I think, you know, I couldn't swear to it that it's not, because they don't, you know, I don't always know exactly what pot that's coming out of to support the Trust. But certainly we haven't seen a huge increase in funding to the work we're doing as a result of the challenge. And we'll maybe, you know, we don't want to plead on about funding, and, you know, there are lots of value to the attainment challenge. But I suppose that's, if there's a perception that there is a lot of money coming to the third sector, from my perspective, I don't kind of see that really. So,
thanks. That's really interesting. But I'm aware that that leads directly into lines of questioning that other members have indicated they'd like to come in on. So I'll leave it there and give them the opportunity to do that. And if there's time later, I'll come back particularly to Jim on some of Aberlour's specific services.
Let's talk about, just Louise, just expand a bit on the way that the Prince's Trust interacts with local authorities. So how does it work? Just talk us through what a relationship with a local authority looks like. Is it with a school or is it with a local authority? If it's through the local authority, is it with a group of schools within the local authority, or is it with individual schools that positively engage with you? How does it work?
Different in different places. I would say it's quite a patchwork. We have some great local authority relationships where we work very closely with the authority, and they will sometimes kind of direct us to which schools they would like us to work with, or which schools are really keen to have an Achieve Club, as we call it, which is our Prince's Trust offer. But in other areas, we might have the local authority might say, well, we wouldn't engage with you, but we can almost broker on your behalf with the schools. So that might be, you know, saying to us, can we talk to individual schools in regards to kind of PEF funding or something like that? In other areas, schools will come directly to us and they'll have heard of our product and they'll be like, we really want to have this in our schools. And I suppose another great boon of the third sector is we can bring investment from outside the public sector as well. So the Trust has a mix of funders, but it does, as a result of that, I guess it's messy. There's different sources of funding. And ultimately for us, it's about, can we be there for as many young people as we can that need our support? So, but the majority of times it is a relationship with the local authority who will, you know, part fund our work and also help us with those relationships with schools. But then once we have that in place, we work with the school directly. And we actually go out and train. It's a member of the school itself that will run the programme. Yes, it's member of staff, often, yeah, you know, pastoral care staff or someone who's really passionate about what we do in employability. And we train them, they go out and run the course, but then we're there, you know, they have a contact for support. And so that's why it's so scalable.
So what is it? You talked to, did you call it an achievement club?
Yes, yeah, so we have Achieve Clubs.
Achieve Club.
Yeah, so that is about, so it's a small group of young people that have been identified by the school that could really benefit from this kind of support. They take it as one of their, usually they would take it as one of their lesson options from S3, S4, and they would, and it's very project based, so they'll work towards a kind of formal qualification, a Prince's Trust qualification, but there's a kind of different strands of, I suppose, a kind of curriculum around it, so they can do preparation for work, health and well-being.
Do the participants self-select, or are they selected? Did you indicate?
It's a mix, I would say. Usually, you know, people like their careers advisor from SDS might recommend to them, if there's an Achieve Club in the school, that might be something you consider. I think it tends to be their guidance teacher, as they're picking their subjects, will kind of recommend them, you know, direct them that this might be something they would benefit from. It tends to be young people that maybe are at risk of leaving with no or very few qualifications. So this is a really great way for them to kind of broaden their qualifications. And what we hear time and again from young people is, I was hating school. School wasn't doing anything for me. What the Achieve Club has done is I've got something on my CV to show. I feel like I've got something to offer employers now.
How do you measure the success of this then? Can you share any measurements of success with us this morning?
Yeah, sure. So, I mean, we work with, I think it's about 1,700 young people and...
In all 32 local authority areas?
It wouldn't be right across all 32. It would be more concentrated than that. I'd have to give you an exact
number. Okay, you can come back to us on that. Authorities. Yeah.
But of that, around about pre-COVID, about 70% of them would be achieving a qualification. I would say during COVID, that's kind of dropped maybe to about 50%. Understandably, you know, schools have had a lot of other things to think about. So, the way we measure it is we do kind of distance travelled measurements. So we have like a My Journey form, which is about, you know, a young person tracking how their confidence is growing, how their, you know, other soft skills, because that's what we think is really important, as, you know, to underpin that attainment. But also we look at things like school leaver destinations. How do they compare to the average for the young people that have been part of one of our clubs? So there's various different ways, and we'll also gather kind of teacher feedback from young people. So there's different routes that we kind of monitor the success of the programme. And it's actually something that we're in the middle of reviewing at the moment with the programme, is how can we have even more impact evaluation behind it, you know, to get that kind of measurement.
Measurable outcomes that you can share with the committee in relation to the population of pupils that you engage with?
Yeah, and we've got data on that.
And it's about positive outcomes, so is that going on to apprenticeships, college? Is that the kind of outcomes we're talking about?
Yeah, absolutely. So going on to something after school, whether it's further education or into employment or into training of some sort. So,
and is it basically your case that for every pound of resource that comes to an organisation like yours, you bring more than that pound, because you say you've got other resources that you call upon, and you basically deliver that additionality, that there's something different that you're bringing that wouldn't be there if you weren't there?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, for example, Apple are one of our partners. So we, with schools in Glasgow, because all the young people have their iPads now, we deliver digital skills that are designed by Apple. You know, they're learning kind of coding and so they're getting access to that kind of, you know, international recognised kind of training, and that's because we're able to leverage in the investment, but also that kind of focus for Scotland's young people from an organisation like that, that I don't think schools would just have the capacity to do. So I think we're able to leverage in funding, but also just really important kind of getting employers into schools as well, and that really important. There's a brilliant stat that Resolution Foundation have of, you know, it's something like if young people have four meaningful engagements with employers during their school time, they're like 85% less likely to not have a destination when they come out of school. So it's that thing of we can bring employers in. We have people like Tesco that help us design some of our programmes. So I think we bring a lot of value in the content that we can bring, but also in the in you know financially as well. But it is. It's
so my concern is that I hear what you're saying, and I can think of examples in my constituency where that kind of interaction is going on between schools, organisations like yourselves, and employers, and all kinds of external bodies that are there supporting young people, which is fantastic. But I also have many other examples of schools where none of that is happening, and where local employers have even told me that they don't feel welcome at all. I'm talking about pre-pandemic, by the way. I'm not just talking about during the pandemic. And they don't feel as invited or, you know, as perhaps they ought to be. Is that your experience as well? I know we're talking in generalities here, but is this a reflection of what the situation is across Scotland from your perspective, rather than just central Scotland, where I'm an MSP?
I mean, it's hard to speak for schools where we're not in, if that makes sense, because, you know, that's not, I suppose, my experience. I mean,
the ones you're not in as opposed to the ones that you're in, as in you'll know what the balance looks like.
Yeah, and I think, you know, we do find there'll be local authorities we talk to, and they will know which schools will welcome in the third sector. And there'll be certain schools that will have everything, you know, and they'll be great, and there'll be a real holistic support around young people, and they might have Maureen's team helping at home, and they might have the Prince's Trust helping in school.
Yeah.
But there'll be other schools where, you know, maybe the leadership in that school just don't see the value in that. And I think, you know, it's, and I know there's this real kind of balance at the moment between devolution of decision-making down to school level, and I completely understand the power of that. I suppose it's that consistency and equity piece that I'm like, I you know, obviously I'm going to say I think every school could benefit from what we have to offer. I think there will be young people in that school that could benefit. But in a way, the barrier, I suppose, is the funding, because we cannot make that offer to every single school without... because we're a charity, so you know, and so we end up having to direct what we do, not, you know, as much as possible. We want to direct it to the young people that are trying to be supported in the attainment challenge, young people from disadvantaged backgrounds. But in a way, we have to move as well with where we can pay for what we do, and where we can, where we can resource it, and then where the schools welcome us in.
Mm-hmm. And the value of what you deliver, which is, you know, about the outcomes. Michael, Mara.
Thanks, Convener. I have to say, I thought that the contribution of the Prince's Trust here, Louise Goodlad, around the transparency of money was a key one that we could come back to in terms of being able to follow. If the organisation doesn't understand where the money is coming from, I have to tell you, it's quite difficult for us to tell at times where the money is coming to follow that. And I see nodding heads from other colleagues as well. That would be a very positive thing. My question actually follows on around that idea of additionality that the third sector brings. And I've had representations from providers in the third sector talking about the amount of resource that they bring to the table on top of the commissioned work. I wonder, Maureen McAtee of Bernardo's, if you could maybe say a little bit about, have you done any research or work in terms of the value, percentage value that you bring on top of the commissioned work that you do?
It's very difficult to do that because it's very variable. It sort of depends what your core service is to start with. So often it's actually easier to lever in more money the bigger your core service is. So for example, if you are commissioned by one individual school to do a piece of work around support to families, it's very difficult to bring lots of additionality to that. However, where you're commissioned across a whole local authority area, it's a lot easier to bring in lots of additionality and really ramp up the offer because you've got that sort of stable core. And I think that's a real flaw with PEF from our perspective, the insecurity that it brings. I mean, most PEF contracts for the third sector are allocated annually. Yeah. We really welcome the fact that there's been a commitment this parliamentary term to clarify with head teachers what they'll be getting over the course of the parliament. But I'm not entirely sure whether that will translate through to more stable contracts for the partners who are in those schools who are currently commissioned. And I think there's also, just to sort of pick up on some of the points that Louise made, I think for us, you know, the innovation and, you know, having things, decisions made very close to communities bring lots of benefits. But there's a real, from our perspective, role for the local authority. We've got direct comparisons where we have attainment challenge funding that's allocated across a local authority versus sort of individual schools across other authority areas. And I think there's so many, that strategic piece that happens when there's a, when it's all connected to the local children's services planning partnership and you're thinking about the totality of resource right across all the different services that work together to support children and young people. I feel that, that you can really make a much bigger difference than the sort of granular work that you can do in a school or a PEF contract. There's so much additionality that can be brought to that. And I think for me, there is, I'm interested in the interface between the work of attainment and the, you know, the Attainment Challenge Fund with other funding streams that come from Scottish Government, because from our perspective, the fragmentation of that can be quite challenging, because from a family's perspective, their needs are not chunked up into that's an attainment issue, that's a family support issue, that's an early years issue. These things are all connected. Yeah. So okay. I think that's why we feel a more holistic approach rather than a school-centric approach is really essential here.
Okay.
In terms of getting out good outcomes for children, young people and families.
Thank you. Can I put a variation on the same question to Jim Wallace from Aberlour? That kind of same question, Jim, around the additional resource that your organisation might bring. I mean, it's been reported to me in my home city of Dundee that those figures from a third sector organisation could be up to 50 or 60% on a contract in terms of those centrally held. And I think that Ms McTeer makes the representation of that on a larger contract. That's easier. I understand that. But do you feel that Aberlour brings that additional benefit?
Yeah, I think we bring lots of additionality, and it isn't always just pounds, though, or kind of financial contributions. You know, since the start of the pandemic, Aberlour has dispensed over £2 million to families, because we recognise that the biggest challenge facing many of our families in Scotland is poverty at the moment. Children can't learn if they're going to school hungry in the morning, and, they can't settle at night in their house if they're too tired. One of our workers was telling me the other week she was asked to go in and help children with their bedtime routines because they weren't settling. And she said, I take in cereal and biscuits and milk, you know, because the real reason they're not settling at night is they're actually hungry. And if they're hungry in the morning when they go to school, they're not in any ready state to learn. So, you know, they're kind of getting kind of finance out to families directly to help them with the challenge. And this is going to be a growing problem. We've got the cost of living crisis coming upon us soon with, you know, soaring kind of energy bills and things. So we bring, you know, a lot of that kind of direct support to family, which impacts on the services we support in schools positively as well. And we're trying to influence, we have teams of people that are actually engaging with children and families to get their voices heard and their views, because this is the real opportunity. If we listen to families about what their challenges are and what they're facing, what the stresses are, the impact on them and then on their children, we can deliver more. So I think our contribution is in multiple kind of arenas around the whole issue of children's learning. I've been in social work for 40 years, and a lot of the issues that we're facing today have been around all through this time, where some, you know, we used to speak the language. The promise has helped us look at language differently as well, because we used to speak about disengaged pupils and disaffected learners. That was very common parlance, which puts the problem squarely on the pupil, the child. You know, and I think it's for us now to kind of turn that round and kind of look at differently what are the real barriers and take responsibility for helping creating the conditions where children learn. And often it's about helping them, building relationships, helping them regulate their emotions and be ready to learn.
Thanks, Jim. Myself and a couple other members of the committee were privileged to visit some of your workers earlier in the week in Dundee, and we heard about some of the work they do. And I think it's really useful you talk about 30 years' experience in terms of social work, because my understanding of some of that conversation was this kind of work used to be done by social workers. Is that fair?
I think to some extent, I think, you know, the kind of pressures on kind of local authorities and social work, you know, have demands gone up really, and kind of resources have gone down. So I think there's, you know, I'd be slow to criticise, but I think there were things that, you know, there was different engagements that social work was able to have with families 30 years ago than now. So, you know, there's a need to try and kind of build back and build the connection between families and those supporting them, and not judge people, you know, be on their sides, not on their backs, I think is the important thing.
And I hear that loud and clear. And, I was hugely impressed by the workers that we met earlier in the week, and, you know, all credit to your organisation for that work they're doing. And the tone of my question, that is not a criticism, is we're trying to understand the money and what it has replaced versus, you know, is there genuine additionality in terms of, is new activity happening, or what we're seeing is money that has been in the public sector now being performing a role elsewhere. I'm not casting aspersions on any of how it might be performed at the moment, which it's just important, I think, we understand whether more is being done, or are we seeing it just done in a different way, I suppose, is that side of it. Can I have a final one, if that's okay, Convener? It's about that precarity of the funding. There's in the written submission, there's some comment on this. I know that it's a core issue for local authorities as well, and for head teachers, how you sustain engagement over a long period of time. Is the threat to this, you know, we've had a guarantee from the Scottish Government around, you know, this year a reduced amount of money, but across coming years for this type of activity to the end of the Parliament. But the challenge with that, is it not that it's set against the local government budget in terms of if the kind of interventions that we're talking about are taken out and that money is used to plug gaps, is that part of the... took from the written submission, I think, from Bernardo's in particular, that was a challenge. We had to see it in the context of local government budgets. Would that be fair?
Sorry, Jim, if I can
bring in Maureen McAteer, and I'll come to you second, if that's okay. Thank you.
Yeah, I think that is fair. Just prior to the pandemic, we had published a report called Challenges from the Frontline Revisited, which really sort of articulated the impact of austerity on services that are provided by the third sector, in this case Bernardo's, but the interface with local authorities. And just to reflect, you know, agree with what Jim was saying, the sort of social work role shifting and changing and being far more focused on the children who are in need of care and protection, and the third sector taking more of a role around that early intervention. Although some of us have been around a long time, these are long-standing organisations with a long history of supporting families and communities. But I think just to also mention in relation to what we do that's different, I think there has been a difference. I can give you an example from one of our services where we had previously a service that's broadly similar to what we do now that was funded by a grant, but it was based in our service versus more or less the same service, but with the outreach element and that connectivity with the school communities. And the difference has been that there's far greater self-referrals. There's a far lower stigma accessing the support. There's a much lower rate of re-referral. So when families get the support they need, it seems to be working much more effectively. And a big part of that, I think, is that those workers and that those supports are visible around school communities. You can go in and get a wee drop in, a wee chat. Somebody can give you a wee bit of light touch support, a wee bit of signposting, and you're averting a crisis. Mm-hmm. Whereas before, it felt like it was harder to reach and get the support that you needed. So I do think that there is a benefit to that interface between community supports and the work that we do, not just Bernardo's, but connecting with other third sector providers across local areas to make sure people are connected with the supports that they need, and the sort of having that access via schools, because people are in and out of schools. It's a service, it's a universal service, so we can reach lots and lots and lots of families that way.
But there's also, Jim, coming to you, there's now a reliance on this work for what you're both describing, I think. In terms of if that is not there, then the social work services that would intervene no longer exist. Isn't that correct?
Well, I think there's been cuts to service delivery. So I think what the voluntary sector, the third sector, are providing now is fairly essential in order to keep, you know, pushing forward for good outcomes. I think there's a question about how we evaluate the impact of PEF and the attainment monies and things. And I think, you know, we need to establish clear measures of success. So, you know, we could talk about the work we're doing in Dundee. In one primary school, we've worked with 60% of the children. There's good feedback on what we're doing there. But how does that affect, does that actually help overall to narrow the attainment gap? I'm just not so sure about that. I think we need to get real strong measures. I think these bits of work are important, but I think we need kind of more fundamental changes and strong commitments towards children's learning going forward. And, you know, one of the biggest things, as I've said, is poverty. You know, if we can't address that, with 250,000 children living in poverty, that will obviously impact on school and their ability to learn.
Great. Thanks, Convener.
Maureen, when you were describing the support that you give families, and you were talking very optimistically about some of the successes you've had, can you just describe in practical terms what that support is to parents and to families?
Yeah. So when we work in schools, we usually have a conversation with the head teacher about what's needed and what's required. So I think that's the thing. It's about, as Louise was saying, it's about trying to have some sort of consistency, but also flex to individual context about what's required. So some of that can be one-to-one support for children, it can be group work, we do social and emotional learning, and also that family support. I think, as Jim's highlighted, poverty is an enormous issue for families, so a big part of our work would be about the material needs of a family and trying to put any mitigations we can in place in terms of child poverty. But I don't think you can underestimate the psychological impact of just how hard it is living in poverty and the impact that has on people's sense of well-being, navigating really complex systems to just survive, and it just depleting people. So there's a lot of support around mental health and well-being. So I think those two things interlink massively. And, you know, the sorts of successes we see are, you know, it's interesting because I think we put it in our written submission. Like Jim's saying, it's very difficult for us to draw a direct line between what we do and an improvement in people's educational attainment. But what we hopefully can do is, you know, kids maintaining their time in school, enjoying school, participating, managing peer groups much better, less, you know, not a queue of kids at the head teacher's door every day because everybody seems to be managing a bit better. All sorts of things around family, you know, families, one of our outcomes is always around family well-being and the family themselves identifying they're getting on better, they're getting the support they need, they feel more in control, they've got more efficacy, they feel they've had their voices heard. So all of those sorts of outcomes are the things that we would look for when we're working with families.
It's hard to measure because it's about people having confidence about, you know, meeting their own challenges and you know, and within their own resources as well. That's quite hard to measure, isn't it?
It is, and it's often a long journey. I think the temptation here to look for quick fixes, and I think, you know, it's a bit, in terms of the sort of backdrop, the context families are living in, and, you know, and we're in rising child poverty, where, you know, the cost of living crisis is, that we're looking at is horrendous, and the report we done prior to the pandemic really highlighted a pretty grim picture, and it's only got worse.
Yeah.
So I think that, you know, there is just so much support that needs to be put in place just for people to keep families stable, because it is such a challenging environment for them to be trying to connect and with schools and give their children the best possible chances.
In your written submission, what struck me, one particular thing struck me actually emotionally, as well as in another respect, was the bit where you talk about, one head teacher told us, this is about people, you know, pupils engaging, sustaining friendships, managing transitions, arriving on time, feeling ready to learn. And when you had this quote, one head teacher told us, if someone said to me, but he's still not meeting his benchmarks, I'd say, but he's in class.
Yeah.
And that, you know, that's the kind of measurable thing that perhaps isn't going to hit any headlines, but it's going to make a tangible difference in the longer term.
if kids aren't there, they're not going to be learning. And I think that, you know, there's so much more to this. And, you know, in terms of what is measured, we've, again, in our submission mentioned the importance of health and wellbeing. And I have to say, over the pandemic, I can feel a real... We've always kind of lobbied and said there should be more focus on that, and it has felt like it's been weighted towards the academic attainment. But then prior to coming here today, I'd actually asked some of our head teachers to give me some feedback, and every single one of them said that health and wellbeing is the foundation. You will get nowhere if the health and wellbeing of the kids in your establishment is not secure, if they don't feel safe, if they don't feel nurtured. You're on a hiding to nothing. It doesn't matter how high quality your teaching and learning is. If those kids are dysregulated, they are not going to be able to make the most of the opportunities that you're giving them.
It's very helpful, and we'll come back to some of those issues. I want to bring in Fergus, because some time ago Fergus indicated he wanted to come in on the funding issue, and that was a point that Michael had raised. So, Fergus, would you like to come in and make that point now and get responses from the panel?
Yes, thank you, Convener, and thank you to the witnesses for their evidence and really for what they do. Over the years, Convener, I have had occasion to work with some of the charities that are giving evidence today, and I recognise what Mr Wallace said earlier, that really what they do is in many ways not instead of, but complementary, additional to, supplementary to what the state does through its agencies. And it does so in a different way very often. And not necessarily all about money. So I just wanted to make that point, that I don't think we should start off from the premise that if we had a perfect social work department, a perfect state, perfect schools, we wouldn't need third sector. I think third sector, actually, we do need in addition. And I think it's easy to get sidetracked by regarding money as the proxy for everything, because it's not. But what I did want to ask, Convener, was this, that over the years, I've been struck that many charities, even leading charities such as Aberlour, Barnardo's and the Prince's Trust, all of whom have various funding streams, as I understand it, from the state and from private sector, from philanthropic donation, all of which is important. However, each has certain funding from the state, and the impression I get, Convener, is that many charities spend as much time chasing the money, which is granted on a very short-term basis from year to year, as they do in performing their function, which is to provide support, in this case, to the most needy. So I've often thought that if the funding were to be guaranteed on a three-yearly basis or a four-yearly basis, that would alleviate the pressures on major charities, and really all charities, quite considerably. Of course, some may lose funding altogether, and that, I'm afraid, is just something that will happen in life. But I do wonder, and my question is this, I'm sorry to be a wee bit long-winded, but you know, have I analysed this in a fair way? And do the charities, since we have them here, spend a lot of time chasing the funding rather than providing the services for which they get up in the morning to provide for young people, in this instance, to tackle the hardship of poverty?
Yes, please, Louise.
We are very aware of that balance between how much we spend on raising funds and how much we obviously spend on our charitable activity. And, you know, that's something that we keep a very close eye on. And actually, I would say, you know, when it comes to something like PEF funding, where it's school by school, we've made a conscious choice not to pursue it, because we don't want to put our resource into trying, you know, we would need a much bigger team to focus on that fundraising and those, you know, if we were going to try and have 300 relationships with 300 secondary schools. So, you know, where we can, you know, we have to follow the money a little bit. So where we do have a relationship, and we can access that, obviously we do, but we are not going out to try and, because for exactly that reason, that we would end up spending a lot more on people like me and less on people like our youth development leads who are out helping young people. And that's where we want the money to be, at the front line. We don't want it to be on us administrators. So so we have to make a really conscious choice on that. But that is part of the reason that we you know, it does mean that our programme and our delivery doesn't grow at the same rate because we're not able to secure the funds to grow it. So it's a constant balance, I would say.
Thank you. Jim?
I think what Fergus Ewan has said is important. I think it would be very welcome for us to get more sustained, guaranteed funding for services on a three-year term. I would have to say our experience in Aberlour is that we've had a lot of stability in terms of our funding coming in. We've closed very few services in the last 6 or 7 years through that. I think sometimes services can close because good services can close through bad decisions. That's always kind of really regrettable, but we've really focused on good relationship management and trying to deliver what we say we're going to do. And we believe that is a kind of that does help with sustainability. We've got some 4-year contracts for some of our family support services down in the borders. We got a funding arrangement for that, and it was based on delivering. I think the challenge for the overall sector is that in the third sector, if we're not delivering, our services will probably be cut, will probably come to an end. I think in the statutory sector, you know, services kind of endure over years. And I think what we need to get to is the position where there's an ability to not just add additional investment, but disinvest in some things that maybe don't work, that maybe don't deliver. And, you know, that's a challenge, I think, for the statutory sector to say, well, you know, we're going to change this, we're going to stop doing this, and there's certain things that kind of prevent that. But I do think to shape a kind of different future in terms of the things we want for children and families in Scotland, we might need to look at disinvesting in some of the things we do and reinvesting that money in innovative and new things that are proven to work. In Aberlour, we've invested our own money in developing services. You know, we do that sometimes in partnership. We'll pay half the cost of a service with a local authority to establish it. We did that recently with a family support service in Falkirk. We put £90,000 of our own money in, and after a year of delivering it, the local authority said, this is working. We will now fund you for 2 years, and they've expanded it. So, you know, we're prepared to put our money where our mouth is, and we're prepared to deliver. I think we need to see that across the board where, you know, there's kind of reviews. Are these services still meeting the needs that they're intended to deliver on? Mm.
Yeah. Thank you, Jim. Sarah.
Thank you.
Yeah, I just wanted to come in to say I think cost of the school day and Child Poverty Action Group in Scotland is a wee bit different to the other organisations here today in terms of our funding through the attainment challenge isn't to provide direct services to children and young people, but it's about working with schools and local authorities on things like awareness raising, professional learning, developing resources to involve their school communities in dealing with financial barriers, good practice gathering, things like that. So it's a wee bit of a different service, a wee bit of a different project. But what I would say that might be relevant is that I think because our funding has been direct and central from the PEF policy unit and has been focused on national development, it has given us the scope to work in a range of different ways with a range of different local authorities and a range of different schools. So that's allowed for the spread of cost of the school day approaches in the widest sense throughout Scotland in recent years. And I think if we had been busy chasing PEF funding to work specifically in, you know, this school or that school, then there wouldn't have been the reach and the impact that there has been so far. I would also maybe reflect on the benefit of local approaches, local authority-wide approaches to work like this. We had a partnership with Dundee City Council over 3 years with local SAC funding. And I think we could see the bigger impact that there could be with a sort of local authority-wide approach than there would have been working in individual schools on kind of awareness raising and kind of involving children and young people in this sort of agenda. So there was there's cost of the school day is ongoing in Dundee now because there was a scope for the local authority-wide approach. You know, they've got statements of intent around how they will be removing financial barriers for their children and families. There's an ongoing steering group. There's the education officer centrally who sort of runs these things. So that's with us having stepped away from that partnership now. I think local authority-wide approaches and funding along those lines, when it comes to cost of the school day, has been really helpful because it means that it can be embedded within the systems that are there already. Thanks.
Does anyone else want to come in? Yes, Maureen.
I'll be very brief. I think just to highlight, given that this committee is specifically about attainment challenge, that there are particular challenges, and obviously the biggest chunk of the money is weighted towards PEF, so for third sector that is a challenge. And also to say that in terms of one of the unintended consequences, so although we've managed to have quite stable contracts across our PEF portfolio, when you employ staff and they only know that they're guaranteed work for a very short period of time, it's very difficult to have the sort of long-term planning, but also that security, because we know that relationships work. And if we can have a system which focuses on ensuring that the relationships are at the heart of how we support our children and young people, I think we will be getting much better outcomes for families. So for me, that's just just a wee point that I wanted to make in terms of that insecurity that's kind of woven through the PEF system.
That's a very powerful point. Bob Doris.
Thank you, convener. Some time ago now, I think Louise Goodlib was talking about really good examples of working with families and young people in secondary schools, about employability, linking with businesses, CVs, entry experience, that kind of thing. It's worth noting, convener, that figures out yesterday showed record levels of positive destinations for young people in Scotland above 95%. So we must be doing something right in schools. And I'm sure the third sector are a key partner in making sure we're getting that right. So there's good things happening, convener. I can't help but say Glasgow were well above the national average attainment levels, which I think is an absolute significant challenge for the city of Glasgow, that young people in deprived communities having really positive destinations. I've got that out of the way, convener. I wanted to say that. I'm very proud of my local authority. Now, it's how we map the role of the third sector within that, and we maximise the benefit of the third sector. Of course, I see that in 2020, an analysis of PEF showed that 43% of head teachers said they were collaborating with the third sector, which means over half are not collaborating with the third sector. Now, there is a contradiction and a tension, of course, because we want head teachers and school communities to have the flexibility to spend that PEF money as they see fit, but I would want to assure myself that they are maximising the wider opportunities out there, including contracting the third sector. So I would certainly welcome some comments about if there's need for more of a formal role in how schools engage with the third sector, without any guarantee that the third sector will necessarily get funding from PEF, but if there's more of a formal structured process that should be gone through in spending PEF. So any comments on that would be welcome, and given that I mentioned Louise Goodlib, I think it's only right that Louise would respond to that first, convener.
Yeah, I mean, I think what we find is, I suppose it's quite a complex landscape, education, in terms of, you've got Education Scotland, you've got the RICS, the Regional Improvement Collaboratives, you've got the Attainment Advisors. There's lots of different bodies that, and I would say pre-COVID, and Maureen and I were both part of this, there was a kind of strategic group that came together with Scottish Government and Education Scotland, a group from the third sector, to kind of have that conversation and strategic overview of what was happening and how the third sector could engage with education. And that kind of fell away, and then understandably, you know, focus has changed over COVID. But I think there's, for me, there's just something really challenging in how we navigate that. And I mean, I don't know how head teachers do what they do. They're amazing. So, you know, and how do, and as someone in the third sector where there's so many offers and organisations, I suppose for me it's about how do we make it easier for head teachers to see what's available, because they can't be an expert on everything. So is it that sits at that local authority level in terms of guidance and coordination, or is it, but I think there's a lot of different forums and ways that, and again it comes down to that thing of how do we make sure we engage in the right places to share what we have to offer, and how do we make it as simple as possible for head teachers to understand what impact, and it always comes back to that kind of what works, you know, how do we really show what works and get the right evaluation, excuse me, of, you know, so that they can make an informed decision, I suppose. I don't know if that answered the question.
Perhaps there's not an ideal solution to this. I'm just trying to work out how we ensure a consistent engagement with head teachers in the third sector in the spending of PEF and the procurement of services. In my experience, my local head teachers are very, very well aware of the really good quality third sector organisations that exist in North Glasgow, and they make use of them. I don't know if Maureen McAteer has a suggestion how we formalise or we put structures around, because the appeal today is that schools and local authorities be using the third sector more. So how do we do that without telling them what they have to do? So how do they keep that flexibility to spend the money as they see fit and still work collegiately with third sector, which I have to say in my area, I'm sure they do, convener. Maureen, do you have any suggestions?
Yeah, I mean, it's probably not a popular one. I do, because I think the empowerment agenda does very much sort of push that delegated authority down to school level. But I know certainly, and just, I suppose, reiterating a wee bit of what I said earlier, I do think there is an important role for local authorities to help around the coordination, and not just in relation to what happens in school, but the interface with other bits of activity that happen across children's services, because otherwise it can all feel a bit bitty and fragmented. And really, the where we have the biggest successes is where there are really strong partnerships, both at the front line, at a team around the child, individual school, but right up through the structures that are in place with local authority colleagues in education, social work, educational psychology, CLD. That's where you get the biggest bang for your buck, when everyone is working collaboratively together to the same end.
That's helpful. How we get to a structure around this without a bureaucracy and still having that local autonomy. I think Sarah Spencer made a similar point about the local authority and schools and getting the balance right and how you can procure around that. So maybe I'll go to Sarah. And, was it yourself that said that, Maureen? My apologies.
No. Can I quickly come back in with one thing, though? Because I think there is something about equity. So, you know, I can give you an example where, you know, a child or a young person, we've got examples of this happening, where somebody may move into kinship care, for example, in a local authority, be getting a piece of support from somebody in a school. That support doesn't follow that child, because it completely, another school might have a different range of priorities that they're funding through their PEF funding. So for me, it's like we're 7 years down the line. There's some things we know that are essential that should be in place for every child and every family, because we've learned an awful lot over this period. And I'm just wondering whether there should be a bit more focus on putting some of those big rocks in place, but still allowing for some flexibility at an individual school level.
I think Maureen McAteer makes a real interesting point. It's one I've had made to me before, but the money doesn't, of course, follow the child. There's an indicator of need within a school and poverty within a school, which gives a financial sum to be spent on raising a team within a school. So it doesn't follow a child clearly when they go to another area. But what I was going to maybe go to Sarah Spencer and ask, is there something around co-production that could be a way forward? When we've got PEF, I think, going to be guaranteed over 3-year periods to allow greater planning. And of course, school head teachers will want to talk to their parent council, the wider school community,
and they'll want to make decisions based on what is in the best needs of the school, who sits within that wider community where the third sector are part of. So is there any good examples of co-production with the use of PEF monies, or is co-production something we should be talking about more in relation to directing some of those funds, keeping the school still in charge of deciding how that money's spent, but knitting in some of those third sector organisations? Maybe it's pie in the sky, Sarah Spencer, but I'm trying to find a way to get a solution around some of this.
Yeah, I mean, I believe there are lots of different pieces of information and data and knowledge that would inform what PEF is spent on in a school. And I think what is really important is that part of that data comes directly from children and young people and families on low incomes. So, you know, the cost of the school day approach or process is really sort of, that's at the heart of it. It's about talking about costs and where they might cause issues or problems in the school with children and young people in a non-stigmatising way. It's doing the same with their parents and carers, given the opportunity to raise you know, mention areas that might be of concern when it comes to costs and also where financial support might be required as well. So that's the whole process, is about having children and families' voices at the heart of that in terms of identifying problems, but also solutions as well, because I think, you know, some of schools are often very aware of what their financial challenges and barriers are for families that are coming in, and it is an increasingly difficult situation for families. Lots of the other witnesses have mentioned this today. It's a you know, really difficult situation financially, and schools are seeing that each and every day with their children and families' financial circumstances changing over the last couple of years or worsening. So I think having children and young people and families at the heart of looking at financial barriers, at the heart of seeing what should happen in their schools is absolutely crucial. I know that part of it's advised that part of your PEF spend should be decided through participatory budgeting processes around that. So I know there's examples to draw on in Midlothian, some work we were involved in there a few years ago that was led by parent councils. I think there are really exciting, I would say, opportunities that we can see with pupil equity groups, pupil voice groups that are kind of so common in so many schools, and lots of cost of the school day groups actually that are sort of springing up at the moment. There's loads of opportunities there for schools to work with their children and young people and with their parents, parent councils, other parents to get the solutions right in school, because actually, if we're talking about the value of the third sector and some of the organisations that are speaking here today, if we're talking about what value they have, then listening to children and young people and their parents and carers about what value these services have brought to their lives and their school experiences and how they're able to engage with school, that's really powerful in and of itself, and I think we should be listening to that.
Thanks, Sarah. Finally, convener, Jim Wallace, where I started my line of questioning was 43% of head teachers report using the third sector. I know in my area they're hugely valued, and many head teachers know the value of the third sector. How do we increase that from 43% and have more significant involvement in a way that keeps schools and head teachers in control of the spend?
Yeah, I think the challenge is just the capacity. I think all the organisations here, I don't think any one of us would have the capacity to engage with every school in Scotland around co-producing services for PEF money, because it's just an immense kind of undertaking. And where we've gone into this kind of arena, it's probably where we've already got a footprint of services where we've got established family support and other services there, and we've got a kind of legitimate place to come on board. There would be areas where if we were coming in to try and establish this without that kind of foundation of our work, it would be very difficult for us to do that. I think what I would kind of commend was in Dundee, they've developed a kind of alliance model where the third sector partners are collaborating very effectively together and not, you know, trying to get out of this kind of competitive kind of scenario where different third sector partners are competing for funds from the same sources. So I think the work in Dundee, you know, kind of is probably quite important to how we go forward with things, because there's the opportunity to say, well, we're all here around the table, but, you know, Action for Children are best placed to deliver this, or, you know, Barnardo's can come into this space and try and, you know, use our resources as effectively as we can, rather than chasing after money, I think, which is not a helpful way to go about things.
Can I thank Jim Wallace for a really good example and practice of how some of that work can be done? That, no further questions, can you?
Jim, while we've got you, you mentioned yourselves, Barnardo's. One of the things the Robertson Trust talked about in their submission to us was that there was some displacement in the third sector, with the larger charities basically rolling over the smaller ones. Would any of you like to comment? Jim, would you like to comment on that? Have you witnessed this? Are you seeing the marginalisation of these smaller charities that the Robertson Trust talk about?
Yeah, we wouldn't want to see that. I mean, I think there's real value in the very small charities as well as the bigger charities. And certainly we've done a bit of collaborative work in Highland, and we're working with, you know, with Barnardo's and Action for Children, but we also have Highland Homeless Trust working with us too. There's good charities there like the Calman Trust. So, you know, I would see the value of the small charities. I think it's hard for them at times, you know, to get into the space. And, you know, I just think we need to get this understanding that, you know, we need to take some of the competitiveness out of it. You know, the third sector's biggest challenge is we're constantly urged to collaborate, but we're also forced in certain ways to compete in tender situations and things. And that's very difficult. I mean, some of the tenders that we put in, and I assume Barnardo's, they're pretty complex undertakings. And I think some of the smaller charities would really struggle to have the resources and the capacity to enter that kind of phrase. So they probably do need some assistance, but we certainly see the value of small charities, and we wouldn't want to kind of dominate them. And I think the space should be encouraged. And, you know, we have partnerships with a number of small charities across Scotland, and it's very, very kind of helpful to us to have those kind of grassroots kind of connections.
The tendering process is supposed to create a level playing field, but in fact, the way you've just described it, it's almost designed to create an uneven playing field, because the smaller charities can't
Yeah, Jim. I mean, it depends how it's done. Sorry, convener. You know, I think that some tenders are very complex and demand a lot of resource and time put into them. And the bigger charities have their development units around kind of working on these things. And they have people that they can pull into it, teams that they can put behind that kind of work. Very hard for smaller charities to do that. And I've certainly spoken to some who've said, we just can't possibly enter into this. You know, I suppose the best thing we can do is try and partner them within our tender submissions to include them with that. And I think if local authorities encourage that, as they sometimes do, that would be a positive step forward.
There's a real risk, isn't there, that this tendering process goes the same way as commercial tendering has gone with local authorities and other public bodies, where it becomes harder and harder for small businesses to get a fair share of what's available in the public sector. And the same thing could be true in the third sector. So I think that's something that we should take note of, particularly in the area of the attainment challenge. Thank you. I'm going to turn to Stephanie.
Thank you very much, convener, and thank you all for being here this morning. I think just before I start, I've got three questions here, but I think it's really good to get that clarity as well about the idea that, you know, our teachers are trained primarily as educators that work with a larger classroom full of pupils there, and that remains the priority, but that third sector organisations get children who are actually struggling to a place where they're ready to learn. So I think it's really, really good to kind of see that today. And it's also great as well to see poverty being put absolutely front and centre of this, because the impact, we call it the poverty-related attainment gap for a very, very good reason. The impact of poverty in our children is absolutely devastating in our families going forward. So three questions that I've got here. The first one is around parental mental health, and I'll kind of target that at Sarah, if that's okay. I'm wondering, you know, how important is parental mental wellbeing, and how big an impact do the practical and financial support that families get, how big an impact does that have on their children's in their children's learning? Now, I know as well we've said, you know, that's something that can be quite difficult to measure. It's not always easy to put it down there. But I want to know, you know, do you see a substantial improvement in children's learning, their progress and their behaviours, etc.? Thanks.
Yeah, I think, you know, we all know that poverty has huge impact on parental mental health. You know, just the stress, the pressure, the anxiety of living in poverty, and, you know, trying to provide the basics for your family and having that as a constant weight on you all the time, that's really, really dangerous for a family's mental health. I think there's an interesting link there with how that plays out in schools for parents and carers, because I think I mentioned in my written submission, we did a bit of research recently for a resource called Talking About Costs and Money at School, because we were quite aware it's a difficult thing for schools, difficult for schools to bring up with parents, and it can be difficult for parents to bring up concerns around costs or financial supports with their schools. So we wanted to dig into that a wee bit more. And when we asked parents in the research that we did, you know, how did it feel like if you would ever, what did it feel like if you were ever engaging with your school on these sorts of issues? We were really struck by what came back. You know, lots of responses that I think just show the power of shame and stigma that surrounds poverty. It was people talking about whether they'd had good experiences or not with their school. They were talking about the feeling of going to do that, go to talk to their schools. It was about fear of judgment. It was about thinking their child was going to be judged as a result of their financial situation. It was feeling guilty they couldn't provide what was needed for their child, whether that was a trip or resources or, you know, whatever it was they were approaching their school about. So this huge sense of guilt, shame, fear, and that's not how we want to see, you know, parents and carers' relationships with schools being. And I think it all ties together into that mental health stigma, shame kind of arena for families. What we did see, though, in terms, what we see all the time, in fact, in terms of what schools can provide for families is that kind of practical help, that kindness, that understanding of the challenges that families are going through. And I think especially in lockdown, we saw the huge lengths many schools were going to support families to apply for entitlements and to sort of signpost or help with financial support, because so many families had drops in incomes, job losses and so on, as we know. So along with those kind of really negative and fearful and shameful and stigma-filled responses that we heard, we also heard about these brilliant things that schools were doing for families. And the impact that was having, I think, on how parents felt. You know, there were, like, a quote that sticks in my mind is kind of, well, two actually, and the first is, we really notice when our schools are trying to help. And another one was around, it really feels like they've got my back. So that's a really powerful thing for families in the context that many families are living in the moment in terms of the financial circumstances. And I think there's a quite clear link between good relationships, good parental involvement and engagement, and better learning for children. So I think looking at stigma and how it affects the uptake of support, you know, both in all senses, but thinking of entitlements in particular, looking at stigma and how it affects things, and looking at ways in which that can be reduced. I think that's essential in this.
Great, thank you very much for that. A question to Jim then. I was having a look at your planning and monitoring paperwork that you use to move young people forward, and it's quite similar actually to some of the work that I've done in my past coordinating education initiative projects there. And I'm just wondering if you could tell us a wee bit more about how that kind of co-production and that that power and control, giving that back to the young person about their learning there, about what kind of impact that's making and how well that's helping you to perhaps actually be able to start measuring some of this stuff, and how we could look at maybe improving that going forward. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you, Stephanie. We're still fairly early days with this. We were prompted really with the pandemic because a number of the children that we are working with are in our residential houses because they can't live at home. And when the lockdown started, I thought that the resources were going to become a bit like pressure cookers, with children not being able to get out to school and not being able to do a lot of their other activities. But what we actually observed was something different, really, that all the children were in the same boat and they were a bit more relaxed. School for certain children is a place where there's quite a lot of tensions, anxieties about going to school, and kind of learning outside school for that period was actually quite positive for some children. You know, they were saying that they were able to get through more work and do things differently. They started their school day a bit later, and there were a variety of different things that were put in place, kind of flexible and personalised. So we put a group together really just to look at how we might work differently and how we might create a kind of different kind of learning environment that kind of meets the needs of these children in a more flexible way. And to do that, we've involved young people and our staff in discussions about how we can approach this differently. And we've had some support from a clinical psychologist that works with us. And it's really about trying to kind of understand all the barriers that are there in place that affect children's learning, from, you know, emotional ones around their kind of low mood, low motivation and high levels of anxiety. And all these things can't just be wiped away, but we can look at how we can address them and then actually create a kind of better place for kind of children's kind of learning. So we're still on this journey. We haven't quite finished that review, but we've had a few examples where we've set up sort of individual plans for children and we're seeing some progress with that. And hopefully we'll be able to report more over the coming months and years on that kind of initiative. I think many years ago there was kind of off-site provisions for children and they got kind of cut down. I think there's some children do very well in mainstream school, and that's obviously the best place, but you know, we need to kind of look at how we can create the right kind of environment and changes in schools that meet the needs of kind of all children. Some of our young people spoke about kind of learning support bases in schools and the stigma there, because sometimes it's seen that the bad children are going to these bases, and we need to kind of find a way to kind of remove that and kind of, you know, create a kind of learning environment that's positive. It's not about kind of taking difficult behaviour out of a classroom and locating it somewhere else in the school, but actually looking at that child's learning needs and kind of building on that. I hope that answers your question, Stephanie. We're not fully on that journey yet. We're just on the road.
It'll be good if you could keep us posted, certainly there. That kind of brings me on to my next question as well there too, about, you know, the wider support that we look at. Certainly in previous evidence sessions, we've been told that, you know, that wider wraparound support from third sector organisations, health, social work, youth work, autism services, justice services, you know, that all of these are absolutely crucial to making sure that our children are able to achieve their potential and do as well as they possibly can there. And we've also got the kind of early years stuff as well, which there's been a huge investment in early years education and attachment, etc. as well. And I know Bernardo's do quite a lot of work around that there as well. So I suppose my question really is about, you know, how important would you guys comment on that and say, you know, how important do you think it is to have that kind of wraparound care and the interagency work, and how can we actually get that working better? Is there something around actually funding joint teams or something like that? Wondering if there's any innovative ideas there that you found to have worked. Thanks.
Is it okay for me to come?
Yeah, please.
Sorry, I was just looking at you there, Maureen. I didn't name you. My apologies. I mean, I think it's a really important point, and obviously today's discussion is focused on SAC, but certainly the attainment gap starts long before a child gets anywhere near a school gate. And I think the expansion to 1140 hours, although it provides some support, it doesn't, you know, it's obviously about children having access to nursery care, and it's not necessarily about support to parents and about strengthening that attachment relationship and providing building the capacity of families to be able to give their very young children enriching learning environments, so that when they turn up to school, maybe the gap could be, you know, not as big as it is currently. And I know certainly from speaking to any early level teachers that you come across will certainly say to you, you know, they would love more intervention, more support to be available to families at that earlier stage. Because obviously by the time somebody gets to P1, some of these patterns are unfortunately pretty entrenched. I think that it's, you know, I suppose I've been talking a couple of times today about that wider system and how important it is in terms of providing that network of support to children and young people, and particularly children and young people where there is a level of complexity, where they may need additional supports that are beyond what's available universally in order to fulfil their potential. So certainly I think that those relationships locally are essential. And just prior to Christmas, we had done a survey with all of our schools-based staff about what was it like, the new normal, what were the issues that were coming up for children and young people now that they were back in school. And the highest, the biggest concern of all of our staff was the mental health and wellbeing of children and young people. And I think that it would be fair to say that even children and young people who prior to the pandemic were managing fairly well are now, there's a significant cohort of those children and young people who have been really impacted by lockdowns. Certainly we've noticed more families where there's a child with additional support needs coming to our attention, because through the pandemic, services that were previously in place for understandable reasons had to pull back from face-to-face contact with families, and families, you know, have been often feeling a bit left and abandoned to navigate a really difficult period in time without the support that they feel they need. So all of those things are really, really important. And I suppose in terms of the connection, given the mental health concerns, I don't need to tell anybody here that the waiting lists are enormously long, but I suppose from our experience on the ground, we think that a lot of those children and young people sitting on waiting lists could benefit from a community intervention. They may not need a CAMHS clinical intervention, but actually if we had holistic support available at a universal or enhanced universal level, we would be able to support them rather than them having to sit and wait for months and months and months only to be seen as not fitting the CAMHS criteria. So we would really like to see, I suppose that's part of what, in terms of the PEF approaches, can we beef up and make some of the things that we know work and that are important to fulfil the needs of children, young people and families, and make them available right across our communities, rather than the kind of individual school approach, because we know that there is a need there that and we could support in terms of the whole system, thinking about trying to get kids who don't need CAMHS into a more community-based intervention at a much earlier stage.
So I think, just to come back in there, I think there were lots of really big and important issues that you touched on there. And certainly we've heard as well in other evidence, we've had the suggestion that actually we should be focusing on our children with additional support needs. You know, we're 30% now, that should be the main focus, and that actually all children will benefit from that. So really interesting to hear. But also kind of going back to what you were saying earlier on there, there has been that real focus on wellbeing and people and their places, and kind of, you know, looking to, there's a drive to kind of co-locate services actually in communities. And I know in North Lanarkshire Council, for example, they're looking at, you know, having kind of hubs where you're dropping your child at nursery, and they're looking for that one parent not to go home and be isolated, but to get involved in either education or in exercise or a cafe and social events and stuff there as well. Would you say that's really the right way forward, what we should be looking at to make sure that we're complementing and supporting the work that's going on with schools and with third sector organisations?
Yeah, I mean, I think these conversations need to take place with local communities, because they'll keep us right about what would work and what wouldn't work. But I definitely think, from the feedback that we've had from families that we support, people want spaces in their local community that are non-clinical, that they can go and get a range of different supports, from very light touch signposting to more intensive support, but in a way, certainly we would never badge any of our services. So we may, for example, get funding to support families affected by substance use, but we would never badge a service in that way, because we want to remove any stigma. Because truthfully, families have got a right to support. Any family can find themselves in a set of circumstances where they need a wee bit of extra help for a short period of time or a long period of time. And I think the promise is challenging all of us to think about what additionality we can bring to try and prevent families from being broken unnecessarily, what we can do to strengthen families, keep people together, but it won't happen without some additionality at that universal or enhanced universal level.
That's great. And just making a point, no more questions, but I think as well the pandemic has been something as well that's just maybe shown all of us that the rug can be ripped from under any of our feet at any time, and that we shouldn't be blaming people, we should be holding our hand out to help people. Thanks very much.
Sarah, I keep seeing your name and wanting to say it the wrong way. I do apologise. Sarah.
Very annoying name, I know.
No, it's not annoying at all. It's me being very dense.
I just wanted to make the point that money is important here. Getting money into families' pockets is absolutely crucial to everything that we're talking about today. It, you know, helps with the mental health sort of difficulties I was talking about earlier. It reduces stress and pressure. It means families don't have to cut costs on things that nobody should have to cut costs on essentials for their families. And also we know that there is a direct link, a causal link between more money in families and children's outcomes and attainment. So that's why focus on income, I think, needs to be core to everything that we're doing. I think there are really good examples of partnerships in schools that look to boost incomes, to maximise incomes. I think in your last session, Laura from the Poverty Alliance had mentioned the Maximise project in Edinburgh. There's also the FISO project in Glasgow that some of you might be familiar with, which is about having financial inclusion support officers based within schools and working in a range of ways with families. And I think that has seen sort of quite astounding financial gains for families, and has also had an impact on
relationships within the school as well in terms of the ways of working. And so, in fact, I was at a sort of online conference type thing the other day, just anecdotally, and this a teacher was saying that in her primary school, they had a family who there were, you know, issues with attendance and various other things, and they tried absolutely everything to improve this child's attendance. And she said that the one thing that made a difference was having, it was the FISO project, it was a Glasgow primary school, it was having that person there doing the benefits check and getting more money to that family. She said attendance was fine after that. It was actually, there were quite practical barriers to that child getting to school on time. So I think that's quite sort of telling of the impact that that can have, those sort of approaches. I think there are also there's also a lot that can be done in schools quite straightforwardly and simply in terms of very clear, open communication about financial support available and support available in the school for example, subsidies for trips and things like that. But that kind of universal information sharing, because as Stephanie says, the rug could be pulled out from any of us at the moment, and always could be. So lots of things that can be done in schools, lots of partnerships that can be made to help families get that money into their pockets. And I think it's important that there's a consistent offer in across schools and across local authorities in terms of that support being available, which probably isn't there at the moment in terms of financial information and support. Thanks.
And Jim Wallace.
I just wanted to follow on that point that Sarah was making about money. We have an initiative in Tayside that's currently funded by the Robertson Trust and CORA, where we're looking to address, we in our family support services, we're providing emotional and practical support, but we're wanting to add a dimension of financial support to families as well, which is looking at their benefits and working with welfare rights and actually maybe writing off some of the debt. A lot of the debt that families are engulfed in is actually public debt, council tax arrears and rent arrears. And, you know, local authorities have discretionary powers to help families financially through Section 12 and Section 22 monies. So there's opportunities to use that, and the thing that we're testing out is if we can help families emotionally and practically, but also help address the kind of the impact of poverty and debt on them, we can maybe put them on a course in life where there's kind of sustaining outcomes in the long term rather than just helping families out of difficulties in the short term. And we're very early days with this, but we actually paid off some debt for a woman who had so many issues in her life with her children, and she started to have a much more positive outlook about trying to get a different housing for herself and her children and starting to train as a hairdresser. So she'd moved from a point of really kind of despair and no hope to a point where she was actually seeing a future for herself. And, you know, if children are living in that family where there's just the constant pressure of debt and things, it's a pretty toxic situation to be in. So I think being able to address family finances and do that. Also, I think we had some links just this week with the WISE group, who are linking in with the kind of big energy companies and trying to kind of get some debt written off for families as well. So I think these are the things that are kind of really important, as well as just the kind of direct services that we're doing. Alleviating some of these kind of financial burdens can actually be what's most important, as Sarah says, to families. And problems that are kind of stuck, like children attending school, can disappear overnight. So, absolutely.
Thank you, Jim. Appreciate that round of questions and answers. Now we turn to Natalie Dawn, who will be followed by Willie Rennie. And I think Willie will probably be the last member of the committee to lead the questioning, looks like, because Oliver has not returned from his break from the committee meeting. So, Natalie, over to you.
Thanks, Convener, and thanks to the panel for all your comments this morning. They've been very, very helpful. So I just want to touch on something that we've kind of just discussed, and that's what my colleague Stephanie was kind of discussing around wraparound care and work with different organisations. So we've just established and we know that poverty is and lack of money is absolutely at the heart of the poverty-related attainment gap. Families have seen their benefits cut this year, the cost of living is rising, food and fuel prices are going through the roof, and I am genuinely worried about the impact that this is going to have on our children. Children cannot thrive in a difficult home environment, and while we're saying that this is about poverty, poverty stems onto many, many other issues and can cause other issues as well. So in terms of, and I'm not saying this is restricted to families on low incomes or in poverty, but generally it can lead to things like drug abuse, alcohol abuse, mental health issues, domestic abuse problems, just these kind of problems at home. And as I say, children cannot concentrate while all this is going on, and families need support with this. So I'm just wondering, and Jim, you did touch on this slightly, I'm wondering if maybe you could expand how the panel ensure that your work is aligned with other services, and whether you think, sorry, I should say, such as things like social work and health, and whether you think that could go further in terms of things like debt agencies or women's services or addiction services. I'll come to Jim first, if that's okay.
Yeah, I think you've just articulated the kind of the enormity of the challenge, and those impacts on children, you know, are massive. These will all impact on their learning. So it is important that we don't just focus on just the educational support and things. You know, we believe that the hours that children are in schools are a small part of it. So being able to get the right support to families and address these issues, and you know, you're right, it spirals. You know, if families are under pressure, you could see domestic abuse and all these sort of things, addiction coming in, people getting engulfed in that, and it just gets worse and worse and worse. So yeah, it is important that we all work together. I think what I mentioned in terms of Dundee is that alliance and collaboration between the third sector and statutory partners needs to be encouraged more, because I think if we're all trying to deal with things in silos, you know, we've often seen the challenge between children's services and adult care, where, you know, the adult care are a bit blind to what the going on for the children, and the children's services aren't thinking about the adult. So we just need to get much, much better kind of collaboration around those kind of challenges for families. And I think there is money being allocated to it, significant money being put into kind of family support going forward in Scotland. And I do think that is absolutely essential that we get the right support. The final thing I'm going to say, because I'm sure others will want to comment on it, one of the things that was a big revelation for us a few years back was it's not just what we provide families, it's when we provide it. You know, so, you know, we started services where we are supporting families evenings and weekends and public holidays. Families told us, you know, our problems don't wait to Monday morning. So we need kind of really a kind of responsive, and, you know, and sometimes families need lots and lots of support for, you know, a couple of weeks until things get better. So, you know, it's very key that what we do to address that kind of myriad of problems that you've just articulated is that we root that centrally in what families are telling us about what would be useful for them and what they need to help them address these challenges in their lives, and not be afraid to go into that space. We have staff now that are going in early in the morning to support families, get children out to school. We've got going in the evenings to support families with kind of bedtime routines, as I talked about earlier. So, you know, it's being able to have that kind of flexible response to families and not have it confined into that kind of Monday to Friday, 9 to 5 kind of delivery.
Thanks, Jim. Yeah, I think it's really important that we don't have all these different organisations working separately with no sort of overall consideration of all the issues that a family or a child is facing at home. I'm not sure if any of the other panel members want to come in, but I did want to bring Sarah in on this, please.
I think something that I think
is probably going to be quite useful, or something that I think makes sense to us as an organisation anyway, is the refreshed attainment challenge and within that wider picture around tackling child poverty, sort of national mission to end child poverty. But I think there is such a, you know, you can't narrow the attainment gap, you can't improve outcomes for children unless you're doing something at the same time on reducing child poverty. And, you know, all partners across Scotland are working to contribute towards our child poverty reduction targets. And we know that what happens in schools, there's, you know, there's obviously, it's just families in schools, isn't it? And there's everything that's happening to them. There's this interplay and an impact of sort of wider policy around, you know, housing and childcare and social security, obviously. So I think the recognition of that, that action in schools to improve outcomes, to narrow the attainment gaps, that can't be done single-handedly by schools. It needs, there does need to be that wider view. And I think the recognition of that is really helpful. And I think as well, you know, if we're talking about, as I've started to do, if we're talking about reducing child poverty as a way of kind of improving outcomes for children and young people, schools are doing that already. And I think there needs to be more recognition of that. The drivers of child poverty in Scotland are inadequate income from employment or social security and the cost of living. So if, when schools are looking at what they do through a sort of poverty aware lens and making sure they're not adding financial pressures to families, making sure that there aren't any barriers to children participating in all of the brilliant things that are going on in their schools, that's helping to bring the cost of living down for families and help with financial entitlements at school means that incomes are being boosted. So actually schools each and every day are contributing to reducing child poverty. And I think situating that firmly within the sort of wider work and wider policy around ending child poverty, I think is really, really important.
Thanks, Sarah. As I say, I don't see any of the other panel wanting to come in on this, but I, that kind of leads me on to my next question, which is around the cost of the school day. So the challenge, we've discussed the challenges for those on low incomes, it's huge, and the barriers that our young people face in terms of the cost of the school day. And I know in the written evidence that CPAG have welcomed the Scottish Government commitment to policies around digital inclusion, the curriculum cost removal, trips and activities. And obviously, sorry, the local examples that were given within the evidence were very helpful as well. But again, with the cost of living soaring, I only feel that these barriers are going to be strengthened going forward. So I'm just wondering if, again, I'm directing this to Sarah, if you could expand on the areas that you believe should be a priority going forward in relation to the cost of the school day. And do you believe that the implementation of these, we talked a little bit about stigma earlier, but that was more stigma for parents. And I'm quite interested in these policies being carried out in a way that reduces stigma for children too and focuses on that. Just wondering if you could sort of elaborate on that. Thanks.
I
know there was a lot in that. Sorry.
Where do I start? So the things I think would have an impact, I think it's at different levels, isn't it? I think at national policy level, you know, we really, really welcome all of the sort of commitments that Scottish Government have made policy-wise and in terms of policies that are going to reduce barriers for children and young people at school. I think one that we would probably point to as being quite urgent, I think, would be the rollout of universal free school meals in primary schools. Which, as you'll know, was promised for August this year, but has been delayed. I think, you know, we just can't underestimate the value of that support for families, and especially in the context that you're talking about in terms of the cost of living crisis and pressures from all sides for families. So I think speed and urgency on that is really, really important, along with all of the other commitments that have been made at a national level. At a local level, I think what might be helpful, I think we've got quite a lot of learning about what works to kind of embed and help to sustain some of these approaches at a local level. And I'd really like to see that kind of be spread and shared and understood and taken on. You know, things like real sort of senior leadership at a council level for this kind of work. You know, the resource there to help push it forward in local areas. Those sort of things are really, really important, I think, because although each school situation is going to be quite individual and the challenges are going to be different in every school and every area is different, there are some real shared challenges for schools when it comes to the cost of the school day. And I think there can be some really helpful shared solutions at local authority level. And I think that local leadership can help to support all the great work that's going on in schools already, because I think the risk is if there's not that local approach, it can be pockets of good practice, it can be schools working in silos, and maybe there's great practice there, but it's not being spread. So there needs to be more of that, I think. And then you mentioned reducing stigma for children and young people in schools. I think that's absolutely critical. We talking cost of the school day around reducing costs and reducing financial pressures on families. And part of that is absolutely about stigma for children, because that can have a hugely damaging effect, feeling different, feeling other, feeling not able to take part, not part of things with your peers. And I think that approaches, I think reducing costs is part of it, and because there are fewer opportunities for children to feel different if everyone is doing the same kinds of things. So that might be about reducing costs, it might be about covering costs for children and young people for, you know, things like trips and activities and clubs and so on. So I think the way that things are done in schools has a direct impact on the stigma that children feel. I think having that awareness that stigma can exist for children and young people on lower incomes is the critical first step within that. And then also, sorry, last point, I think also adults sort of deciding how we reduce stigma for children and young people, you know, we're probably onto plums a wee bit with that, which is why I think the sort of groups that I'd mentioned before in terms of people voice, people equity, social justice kind of groups that exist in schools, I think they will be able to tell us best how stigma is reduced for them. And that's an area we're really interested in looking at a wee bit more with children and young people. It's a very broad, long answer for you.
No, that's really helpful. I think I think the stigma thing is really important. And I know, and as you mentioned free school meals, I think it's about the way things are acted out and the way things are done within schools. I remember when I was in school, the way you got your free school meal, you stood in a separate queue and got a dinner ticket, and you were very much in the small group of people that had a dinner ticket. And it's nice to know that things like that are phased out now. But it's just, I think it's so important that we continue to work and make sure and work with young people, as you've said, and discuss it with them about how we can make sure that's reduced. I'm conscious of time. I'm happy to leave it there unless any of the other panel members want to come in. Thanks, convener.
Thank you, Natalie. I appreciate that very much. And our final question round is led by Willie Rennie.
Thanks very much, and thanks for all your evidence this morning. I think it's been very compelling. I'm interested in just trying to be precise about what we want to change about the attainment funding, because we're spending hundreds of millions of pounds on this, and we need to know that it's working effectively. And I take all the points about the wider society. I take all that. But this is hundreds of millions of pounds that's been spent directly with councils and with schools, and we need to make sure it's been spent effectively. So there's references in the written evidence to what things should be done to make it better, what improvements should be done. So I'd just like to draw those out. And perhaps we could start with Louise. If you could maybe tell us, what precisely would you want to improve about the way that we use the attainment funding, how it's allocated, government policy, all of that? What would you like to change?
I would say I'd like it to be more transparent and clearer where the funding has gone and what impact that money has had. And I say all of this caveating it as that information might be out there somewhere, but it's not easy to find if it is. So if it is out there, let's make it easier to find so that we're really clear on what works and what is having an impact. I'd like there to be a greater connectedness from the education system with the third sector. And again, I think that happens in pockets. And I think, you know, I've heard in the last session about Northern Alliance and the Dundee Alliance, and that's great. But I think how can we get more consistency and just greater, again, visibility of how the third sector can be part of the conversations.
Could you talk about regional and national forums which to share best practice? Mm. Is that what you mean? Why don't they exist, do you think, just now?
The regional improvement collaboratives do exist. My sense is, and this is speculative, but what I find is often education looks within education and not always outside of that. And so, you know, that kind of encouragement, and I know it's always a bit like Bob was talking about, is how do we get that balance between enforcing, which is not what we want, but encouraging and, you know, making maybe some of that encouragement stronger around working with the third sector and really understanding what the third sector has to offer and can bring. And then I suppose if I was, if I'm First Minister for a day, then I'm kind of going, is it about the third sector having a direct route to the attainment challenge so that we can, for me, it's about how can we stop talking about funding? So it's actually about what's the best opportunities for young people. So, and in some ways, if there was enough funds for interventions that we can see work, then can we make it that we're not imposing them on schools, but that schools can choose to have them if they wish without that third sector organisation having to go four different places to try and fund that. So how do we take that? I'm not giving you a direct answer.
Good, that's good. That's good precision. Jim, do you want to come in next?
Yes, okay, thank you. I mean, I think it's a difficult challenge in terms of governance because we've put it down to the low level of every school, you know. So I think if the local authorities had the money and were then accountable for reporting to the government and on how it had been used and where, and there were kind of clarity on that, that would have that might have been a useful way to go. But I suppose the danger of that would have been it might have robbed away some of the individual, you know, the control of individual schools to do it. So I think you can't probably have your cake and eat it, would be my feeling. You know, if you want kind of governance on it that is kind of a higher level, you need to have some sort of mechanism that it's reporting through all the local authorities back on what every initiative's doing. I'm not sure that's there at the moment. You know, we can report on the things that we are funded for and whether that's successful and whether we see the benefits of that. But how is that kind of assembled in a kind of more macro level? I'm not sure how that works and what are the kind of global measures of success that are there for this. I suppose the main one is that we see a narrowing of the attainment gap that's kind of measurable. So, I just think it's quite hard to wind that one back, I think. Now, you know, there's a decision to put it out and make the decisions in the schools. The head teacher had the kind of the power to choose how best the money was spent. But we really want to know how, on a macro level, that's affecting. So,
okay.
You know, there's a wee missing governance loop in that for me, I think.
Okay, thank you very much.
Is that helpful? I don't know.
No, it's very good, very good. Maureen, do you want to come in?
Probably along some of the same themes. So things I've probably already mentioned today. So longer term funding so that we can actually have a embed into school communities and embed change over time, and sort of link to that, how that links at a local authority level. So you have that strategic link and that idea of that we use the totality of our resources in a strategic and coherent way that makes sense.
Because in your evidence, you say it's not clear, because Bob rightly pointed out that it's now going to be three-year funding on the PEF, but it's not clear whether that's feeding through to you getting three-year funding.
Yes.
And why is that?
Because I don't think there would be an expectation on schools that they need to commit to a three-year. I think woven into the guidance, it's very much if something's not working, stop it and try something else. Now, nobody's going to advocate you throw good money after bad. However, some of the complex issues that some of the children and young people and families have, there is no quick fix. It takes a long time to build the relationship, to build the trust, to get the right support in place, to take the child or young person family on a journey that ultimately improves their outcomes.
So that probably comes back to part of the best practice sharing that Louise was talking about, that collaborative thing. How do we make sure that head teachers and third sector organisations and everybody else who's involved in this is sharing that understanding that you do need to commit to, now that you've got the opportunity to commit to longer term funding, that perhaps that is an example of best practice?
Yes.
Would that be fair?
I think some of the measurement around SAC has been quite weighted towards academic, about literacy and numeracy. You know, a lot of head teachers have said to me, I'm desperate to focus on health and wellbeing, but not long after returning to school post-pandemic, I'm being asked to provide tracking information about where children are at in terms of their literacy and numeracy. Now, no one's saying that's not important, but it's very, as soon as you're forced to report on certain things, it can weight where you put your attention. And I think that we need to be balanced around that, because this pandemic has had an enormous impact on the health and wellbeing of our children and young people, and we need to think about ways of retaining the focus on that.
Okay. Sarah, I don't know whether you'd like to come in on this as well.
I think if we're talking about awareness of poverty in families are facing, and also action to sort of tackle some of that in schools. And, you know, I could go on for hours about all the good examples that are there in terms of schools working to do that. Lots of different interventions everywhere designed to improve participation for children and young people. So if we're talking about those things, awareness and action, I think there has been real progress in the last few years as part of the attainment challenge on that, in terms of that understanding and that kind of motivation, I suppose, to put things in place. I think in the DAC evaluation it had said, you know, similar thing, there's been lots of progress and awareness, but it was still saying that there were gaps and that there were still schools in areas maybe where fewer children are in poverty that we're saying that they were less aware of those things. So it's an ongoing process of embedding these ways of working, I suppose. And I think that really needs to continue.
Thank you.
And there needs to be a strong focus on that going forwards, and share and learning about what works as well. I think those things are all helpful.
Thank you very much. I just want to finish with
I think for me, what summed up how the PEF funding can work very well. When we visited the school in Dundee on Monday, there was this wee boy who described what he was like before and after the intervention. And he said, when I used to get things wrong in the class, he used to lose his temper, stamp his feet. He would be out in the corridor shouting and bawling. Now he just rubs it out and he starts again. And I thought that summed up brilliantly how this intervention can work and make a real difference for young people, and we just need more of that. Finished.
Fantastic. I can't think of a better way for us to conclude this session. That was a great anecdote. Thank you this morning to Jim Wallace, Maureen McAteer, Sarah Spencer and Louise Goodlad, who have been giving evidence to our committee as we continue our inquiry into the Scottish Attainment Challenge. And with those thanks and appreciation, I conclude this morning's meeting. We will now suspend and I'll ask members to reconvene on Microsoft Teams for our private session, which allows us to consider further agenda items. Thank you very much and good morning.